Thunder Talk Radio, you're in to all things music.
But doing that shot and guzzling this hot beer, feeling that change in my metabolism, feeling that the smoothing out, so to speak, of where then the shakes kind of stopped and I relaxed, right. My heartbeat kind of calmed down. I finished my smoke and I went up to my hotel room, and I remember walking and sitting on my bed, looking around the room, realizing, wow, I'm buzzed again. And now I feel calm, and actually thinking, holy shit. Like if this is the mm-hmm. cycle, if it's gotten to this point physically, now I'm in for it.
Groove. Come journey with us through the rhythm of the music business with your host, Jackie Bertone.
So originally it was called Everybody Wants to Go to War.
And it doesn't have the same ring.
It just doesn't, yeah. Confessions time. It was like, okay, you know, we couldn't really sing it, but what was great was when we were doing Big Chair, Chris Hughes, the producer, at the end of each session would get us to play that song. And we played it so often that we began to wear it. And eventually the lyrics changed to Everybody Wants to Rule the World. And it was like, oh, okay. Yeah. It was also our move away from, you know, introspective lyrics into looking at things globally. And the slight shift in perspective towards politics, which came out much more in Caesar Love.
Everybody, welcome to Jackie's Groove. Hey guys, this is Jackie Bertone, if I haven't pounded that in your brain already. And we're brought to you by the infamous Intertalk Radio Network. Everything, we're the best. That's the bottom line. Hey guys, that song has got to be one of my favorites of all time. Now, the gentleman I have on the show today, usually the people that I introduce and the people I interview are friends of mine for 15, 20, 25, 40 years, etc. This gentleman is a new friend of mine, but his group that he works with is no stranger to myself and, of course, everybody worldwide. He is celebrating going on 7.5 years on the drum throne with this iconic legendary band called Tears for Fears. That was formed in 1981, and they are still relevant today. So, but guys, with that said, I am proud and privileged to welcome to Jackie's Groove, and I want everybody to welcome with open arms and open ears, Mr. Jamie Wollam. Jamie, welcome to Jackie's Groove, my brother.
Hey, Jackie, thank you so much, man. Thanks for having me.
Oh, man, it's great. I've been, as I use the term, and I mean this friendly-wise, I've been overdosing on Tears for the last week and a half since you and I have been talking.
Yeah.
And, I mean, what an honor, man. What an honor. You know, Jamie, I go back, you know, and just my memory, which is coming back here and there, back in 86, 87, mm-hmm. I played actually at a huge outdoor venue in Palm Springs, and I was working with a gentleman by the name of Jimmy Hopper and also with an infamous band called Wang Chung, and Tears was actually going to headline, but they could never make the show because we had a huge windstorm, and that was the end of it was sad. But of course, sitting there looking at the curly hair of Roland Orzabal and Mr. Mm-hmm. Kurt Smith. So with that said, everybody, let's chop it up with Jamie. Let's find out what it's all about, where he started out, where he's going to, and hopefully there's going to be no end in near sight. So with that said, talk to me, Jamie. Tell the listeners out there, where were you born? Where were you raised? And as I ask everybody else, have you ever grown up?
Well, yeah, let's start with the simple ones first, and then I'll get more into detail about the growing up part, I guess.
Please,
but
please.
I live in L.A., in Los Angeles, in a suburb of L.A. called the South Bay, Manhattan Beach area. But I was born in California, in Los Angeles area, in a little suburb as well, just east of Pasadena, called Glendora. So that's where from Glendora. Grew up, went to grade school there, went to high school there, and then just after high school, moved to Pasadena for a couple years while I attended, for those that I'm sure you probably know it, Jackie, but a place called Musicians Institute.
Absolutely.
So I'm a graduate of P.I.T., proud graduate of P.I.T. from just after high school. And and then I moved down to the South Bay when I was about 26, 27, and I've been here going on about 20 years. So still native to L.A., love it, had the privilege of traveling many other places, but still, and oddly enough in this business, it's kind of rare that you're from mm-hmm. L.A. or you're in L.A., and when people ask you where you're from, you actually say L.A., you know?
Yep. And through the marvels of travel, it doesn't mm-hmm. matter anymore. I mean, I remember when, you know, I grew up in Whittier, you know, I lived in Orange County. And I always heard the rastest shit from everybody saying, "Wow, I can't believe it. You know, you're a yokehead in the industry, but you live in Orange County." The thing is, you know, you don't have to be in L.A. if you have already, you know, planted your feet. But if you're a young cat and you're starting out, you want to be in the thick of things. You want to make sure that you are readily accessible. But Jamie, think about all the friends that we know in common that have planted, you know, made a thumbprint in the industry. They're in God's country. They're in the outskirts, because all you need to do is get a cell phone and a plane ticket. And everybody converges together on one big happy stage. So, you know, things have changed.
That's definitely, you know, I've realized that as I've gotten a bit older and I've gotten a bit more deeper into the industry, that a lot of times mm-hmm. on a professional level, it does allow you some flexibility to live as long as you're close to an airport, you know, and
exactly.
I've had some opportunities here and there to live at different places and thought about it. Different times in my life, but I just mm-hmm. I always have found that LA is my home, and you know, I've got a couple of kids, and so they're still here, and so to move away just seems like it would be a bit more of a self act than it would be. And like I said, and bottom line is, I still love it here. I love to travel, and
of course,
I love the one thing I do. I love experiencing the four seasons of a year. You know, where LA sometimes you miss out a bit of that. I love being back east during the fall when you get to see all the colors change, and I love being places. I love visiting places that are really cold and snowy, but I love coming back to LA.
We have four seasons here, brother. We have earthquakes, we have drought, Santa Ana winds, and we have smog.
That's what I can call the LA four seasons as well. It's either clear, smoggy, an earthquake, or drought. Yeah. Is it the day I can water my lawn or not water my lawn?
Exactly. Or wash your clothes after 7 p.m. So God bless America and God bless California. Hey, you know, you just mentioned a second ago, you mentioned your babies. Let's talk mm-hmm. about your doppelganger, your son at 20 years old. Is he a musician at this point yet, or is he dabbling?
Both of my kids, oddly enough, my son Carter will be 20 in July, and my daughter Bailey will be 10. She's about 9 and a half. She'll be 10 in December. And both of my kids have an incredible knack for music and musicality. My son Carter has been around the business since he was born, and plays the drums himself. He doesn't play as much as he was about 3 or 4 years ago when he was in his first kind of high school band with buddies and. But he's a very talented, very natural drummer. And my daughter Bailey, oddly enough, has an incredible singing voice. Like really, and I know it's easy for people to go like, "Oh yeah, of course he's going to say that because he's her dad." But no, I'm talking like blow your mind singing voice for a 9 and a half year old. So, but I, you know, it's odd too. Music is one of those things that I think it's just a really organic thing with both of them where I've never pushed. them into it or never encourage them to take lessons or do anything. I just always been playing. Yeah. I want it to be whatever they continue, if they do continue to pursue any part of it, that it just be a real natural and organic thing. But I think it's obviously natural for them to an extent, because they've been around it. Both of them been around it with my life, their entire life, you know?
You know, and that's a good point too, because I wanted to ask you, a lot of my interviews, a lot of my friends I know of their babies, I used to hold them in my arms, and now they're driving and having kids of their own, which blows me out of the water, shows how old we are. But with that said, let's go back to Bailey for a quick second. Mm-hmm. And I love the fact, how come we lost the ability to say, well, I'm 57 and a half years old? You know, we lost that as adults, but with her being 9 and a half, does she get what daddy does? Does she get it at all in the full realm of what papa does?
You know, she went to, it's an interesting question, and thank you for asking it. She didn't, I don't think, really understand or get it, because she hadn't been to any of my live performances. There's always been a drum set set up in my house or my studio or things like that, or me playing guitar around the house. But she had not ever seen me play a live show until this last past September, when I finished about a 3.5 week run with Tears for Fears, and we ended up finishing our tour in San Diego at a place called Humphrey's. You know that you're familiar with Humphrey's by the Bay.
Concerts by the Sea, baby. I played there more times, and I want to admit the best venue. I think it's 1,100 seats. And if you guys haven't been down to Humphrey's, I played there with, oh my God, with Cecilia Capone, with Tower. I mean, I can go down the list of where we've played there, and it's probably such the most beautiful. Yeah, it's just the setting
really,
is amazing.
It was outdoor, beautiful venue. The thing I love. Am I allowed to occasionally, if I throw out a profane word, is that that's okay?
Fucking A, brother.
Oh, okay, okay. I was gonna say you just eased my pain. The thing I love about Humphrey's is the amount of shit given to the crowd that decides to not buy tickets for the show, but pulls up their boats, all the boats that get lined up in the water around the venue, because it's so beautiful. It's right on the water. But a lot of people, you know, get their party boats and get a great seat just sitting from their boat. And I love it that some of the artists I've worked with have thrown shout outs and then have obviously given shit to the people that, you know, just pull up in their boats. But
That's so cool. Let me jump in. I'm just trying to draw a picture, because you just said the boats. Because when you are in the audience, to the right of the stage is the hotel. To the left of the stage is the harbor. And if you're on stage, obviously, right's the harbor. Left is the hotel. And they have different packages available. And by no means, this goes out to my dear friend of mine that runs the organization, Tim Mercer. Hey, Timmy boy. Yeah. And the fact is that with that, they actually just Jamie, they just actually released their 2017. Calendar, and I don't know if Tears is on that at all. I haven't seen that deep of it, but you guys go on to Humphrey's, just Google Humphrey's Concerts by the Sea or Concerts by the Bay and check it out, because it's amazing. And also too, with Bailey, that whole vibe back there, it feels like you're in the tropics, you know, backstage.
Absolutely. And
I also want to give I want to give shout out too, because this thing about us as musicians, we love to eat, and they have probably the best commissary backstage area for food. That banquet table they put up for us is quite enjoyable. So with that said, go ahead.
I've played there a couple times, and both times, three times I have, it's just been top notch. They take care of the artists immensely, and it's such a beautiful venue. My daughter, like, so going back to the point is that my daughter had never seen me play live with a group until that show, and I brought her to that show, and she was in heaven. I mean, not only just running around the hotel and swimming and looking at the fish they have in some of the streams there and the view, but then to actually sit and watch the show. And then she got to walk me on stage, which is really cool. She walked out with me and my drum tech as we walked out to start the show and gave me a big kiss, and then got to go sit and watch the show. And afterwards she just, she gave me a big hug and said, I had no idea this is what you did, and it was so much fun, and I'm so proud of you. And this is coming from a 9.5-year-old, so it was really awesome.
How beautiful is that? Because, you know, Jamie, when you're up on that riser, when you look to your right, you have that big swing out door that connects to the stairwell down, or the little elevator that I use because of my little scooter, or you exit stage left, which is right on the corner there too. So, you know, at least you got a chance to walk up those 8 stairs and to see where daddy was.
Exactly.
You know, and And I don't know if that was filmed at all, but I'm sure you can go on YouTube and put in Tears for Fears Humphreys. I'm sure there's probably somebody shot something somewhere. So with that said,
I got to share something really quick about that I find very humorous is
please.
Just about a week ago, I was driving with her downtown. We're going up, heading up to the valley, and we were driving through downtown and we passed the Staples Center, and she had overheard, because she's aware of that I'm getting ready to go on the road. And she had heard, was aware of the news that this current tour that's getting ready to kick off with Hall & Oates, they added a second show here in LA at the Staples Center. So two nights at the Staples Center, which for me, as an LA guy, you know, the Forum growing up, the LA Forum was always the big thing. And I've gotten to play the Forum now a couple times with Tears, and now having getting a chance to play the Staples Center, which is amazing. And the second night. And so we were driving up and she pointed out the Staples Center, and I said, yeah, that's where Daddy's going to be playing. And she said, wow, that's fantastic. And I, as a joke, said, you know, hey, your dad's kind of a big deal. And we all kind of laughed, and notable pause about 5 seconds later, she goes, Dad, if you're such a big deal, how come you're so broke? And I had from the to mouth, laugh.
From the mouths of babes, baby.
And
from the mouths
of babes. And I just thought, wow, that is fantastic. And then, you know, so we laughed about it and she laughed and it was a big deal, you know, a big joke and whatever. So, I mean, I guess the beauty about that is that she loves to help keep, she's one of the biggest enforcers on keeping myself incredibly humble and focused on the important things, you know?
Absolutely. You know, because like I said, I've had so many interviews. And I say it all the time. It's, you know, you can go out, especially in this industry itself, as I said it before, and I'll be reiterate and redundant. But the fact is, there's nothing glamorous of what Jamie and Jackie does. I mean, it's a hurry up and wait game, and it's the glamour doesn't start until the lights go up. And, you know, and depending if you're headlining or if you're a supporting act, it's still, it's a bunch of, the best part about it is just hanging out and bullshitting with everybody. And, but the thing is, I brought that up just for the fact that, you know, the glamour part of the whole situation, you know, with this upcoming tour with Tears for Fears supporting Hall & Oates. I mean, you think about it. I mean, look at these bands. We're talking bands that the Infantile stage in the early 80s, and they're still killing it. Staples Center, guys, this isn't the Coach House, nothing against the Coach House. But, you know, we're talking 19,000 people that I'm guarantee you it's going to be sold out. So there's a reason, youngins out there, that the old boys are still doing and still staying relative, because the fucking music is right.
Yeah,
the music
amen.
Makes sense. It transcends. And so, you know, I can't, Jamie, I can't believe this. We're already coming up to 1 minute on this. Do you see how fast it's blown by?
Yeah,
we've amen. We've got so much to talk about. We've got so much to talk about life. We touched on the family, but I do want to come back to family. I want to talk about siblings and such and blah, blah, blah. And we just want to kind of get that. And then we're going to move forward and we're going to talk about not music, not so much family, but realize when it comes to each individual person and our struggles in life. So we all have them, guys. We all have them, and some are greater than the others. But you know what? We all have our own crosses we have to bear. Totally. So when we come back, we're going to, you know, it's not going to be an Oprah moment or Barbara Walters. I'm not going to get invoked tears from somebody or the listeners out there. But we do want to talk about Jamie's struggles.
Yeah.
Struggle is real, as the kids say it, and so on and so forth. But you know what? You're here. We're talking about it, and you're coming out on the other side of the rainbow. So.
Amen.
But that said, guys, don't go anywhere. This is Jackie Bertone. This is Jackie's Groove, brought to you by Inner Talk Radio Network. Guys, don't go anywhere. Stepping out of segment number one and into segment number two with the iconic rock drummer, my new dear friend, Mr. Jamie Wollam from Tears for Fears. So, guys, here comes that bumper music. Don't go anywhere. Get yourself a drink. Use the bathroom. Don't want to miss the next episode. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Are you serious about your music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it, because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on Inner Talk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
I'm Tim Dolbear, the host of Sound Experience on Intertalk Radio. Each week, I talk with top professional audio engineers, producers, musicians, and the manufacturers that make the tools that we use in the studio each and every day. From capturing the perfect take to mastering your final release, and the tools and how the pros use them, we are going to dive deep into their process and learn from their experience. I look forward to you joining us each week on Sound Experience with me, your host, Tim Dolbear.
Make this your vinyl night. I'm John J.R. Robinson, and every week, music creation comes alive through stories, experiences, and sounds when vinyl records filled our hearts and minds. My friends and I share our tips and techniques used in creation of iconic tracks for recording artists such as Michael Jackson, Eric Clapton, Quincy Jones, and Steve Winwood, to name a few. Vinyl has emerged hot, and the soul of vinyl defines art and passion, which burns deepest at night. Tune in every Wednesday at 2 p.m. Pacific Standard Time on
Jackie's Groove. Come journey with us through the rhythm of the music business with your host, Jackie Bertone.
That song is called Frozen Fish by my in-studio guest today, Mr. Jamie Wollam. You know, and before we get going, I just want to tell everybody out there that's listening, when you can't hear our live performances, do yourself and do us a favor. Go on to iTunes or Google Play and download our easy-to-use Navigate application. Two words, first one being Intertalk, second one being Radio. You can take Jackie's Groove and the plethora of other shows that Intertalk brings to you worldwide on the go with you. And it's a beautiful thing called streaming, my friend. Hey, Jamie, welcome back, brother. You know, I want to talk about things that you and I have talked about before. You know, as always, we've had a past, mm-hmm. we've got a present, and God willing, we'll have a future. And, you know, I just want to go back to Bailey's mama.
Sure.
I'm a big fan of hers. And I say that Bailey's mama because I don't think you had anything to do with that at all. But that Bailey's mama and your ex and still dear friend, one of the, to me, a great character actress. You met her on Meet the Falkers. Her name is Terry Polo. And so, Terry, if you're listening, man, I'm a big fan of yours. And there's a nice correlation between that since I've already hosted people from Barbra Streisand's band. So there's our correlation.
Yeah. Amen.
So with that said, hey, now, Brother Boyd, Frozen Fish, tell the listening audience where the genesis of that tune came from, et cetera.
Well, it's an interesting thing. And thank you for giving that some airtime. I'm really proud of that. That song is part of an EP that I produced, co-wrote and produced with a girl by the name of Chloe Catterndall, who is from this area too, the South Bay area, that I met. She's finishing up her senior year at Belmont in Nashville right now on a songwriting scholarship that she attained. But I, long story short, about 4 years now, I was walking my dog in Manhattan Beach, just out for a nice stroll on a Saturday. And I was walking my dog and I heard this sound coming from the park next to where I was walking my dog. And I swear it sounded like someone's stereo because there were some houses around and I thought it was someone playing music from their stereo. But you know how you can – but very quickly I realized it had this sort of sibilance that I knew wasn't a stereo. It had this sibilance to it that I could tell it was live. But I couldn't tell where it was coming from. So I just kept walking, but noticed, man, it sounds really good. And lo and behold, right. about five minutes later, I stumbled upon this girl, Chloe, sitting in the park on a blanket with a couple of her high school friends just playing her guitar with this voice that was just incredible. And so I ended up introducing myself, which, of course, kind of I knew the looks that I were getting from these high school kids looking at me, you know, walking my dog saying I'm a musician, blah, 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 blah. And but then I slowly, you know, explained who I was and extended my information to her and said, I would love to. This is just at a point in my career where I had really started wanting to open myself up to doing some more other than just sitting behind a drum set, you know, because I've played guitar my whole life and have messed with writing songs and had just been investing in building a studio in my place. And so long story short, we got together and started writing, and this girl is just top notch. And so it was a really beautiful experience. My first real experience sort of in manning the boat, if you would, towards writing and producing and engineering and recording about six songs for her. So it was and she's doing fantastic. She's in Nashville, like I said, finishing up her last year at Belmont College. Incredible songwriter, incredible performer. Like I said, her name is Chloe Catterndall, but she goes by the name Chloe Cat. She's got that EP is out on iTunes. She's gonna be a name to it's gonna be hard to ignore that name in about another year and a half. So
write that name down.
Yeah, Chloe Catterndall. She's incredible. And so that was such a great experience for me, which really kind of ushered me into the world of songwriting and you know, producing and mixing and stuff as well. So really, really happy for that.
You know, it's so cool that you mentioned the fact about playing other instruments. I did catch a video, a performance with you and Kurt on mm-hmm. YouTube on Everybody Wants to Rule the World, and where you were playing guitar. And I mean, I kind of did a double take, and I go, watch Jamie playing guitar.
Yeah.
You know, and that was a very, very cool situation. Guys, do that. Go on. Everybody Wants to Rule the World acoustic, Jamie Wollam and Kurt Smith. And man can play. You can play a little bit, brother. You know, a few more lessons on drums, you're going to get this whole thing also, too, which is, a very cool thing. And, you know, and the thing about just being around, understanding things going on, you know, we've talked about things. The industry knows, you know, about Jackie Bertone and my struggles in life with multiple sclerosis, you know, but I've used my name and my likeness and my worldwide fame for the greater good, because if we can always help just one person,
yeah,
then we've done our job, you know. And, you know, and Jamie can't hide from the fact that he's human, but Jamie also is coming up, if not already surpassed, 2 years. And brother, forgive me for being right up front, man, but I'm proud of you, man. Jamie's curse of choice is a thing called alcohol. Jamie, share with the listening audience out there and other people who are survivors that are in recovery. Mm-hmm. Tell your story.
I mean, that's probably about a 10-hour show, but I've learned to be able to consolidate it to really the basics of my story and my deal. And the bottom line is, you know, I started as a lot of people that I do know who are musicians as a career, who started very young, but it just went hand in hand with the scene. And by that, I mean, when I started playing drums when I was about 13, eighth grade, and my first band, I was playing in a garage with a couple of friends of mine from school. Within about 6 months, we were playing, you know, Iron Man and Sweet Leaf and, you know, Black Sabbath songs in my buddy's garage. And it just went hand in hand that we would go out and practice for 3 or 4 hours and then wanted to go get drunk. It was just kind of the thing, you did. And it was taboo. And we'd sneak, try and sneak our parents alcohol. We were very successful at it, obviously. And it just kind of went hand in hand. And, you know, the scene that goes along with professional entertainment, you know, here's what I've come to realize, Jackie, is that it doesn't matter. Obviously, it doesn't matter what you do for a living. You know, there are lawyers that struggle with and doctors that, you know, go into the bathroom stalls at their work and chug gulps of alcohol or snort lines or whatever before they go to work. The difference. So the struggle is real for anybody in whatever profession. The difference that I have found within music is that there's very few places that actually sort of cater to that lifestyle, asking you, you know, what kind of alcohol do you want backstage before a show? And then the party continues after a show to wherever club you go to, or the restaurant or the bar afterward, right, where it's just so prevalent that everyone is there to, quote, have a good time. And so it's almost, or you go into a recording session and one of the first things you may be offered is a drink or a hit off of a joint or some sort of stimulant or relaxer to sort of get you, quote, in the mood and in the groove. So it's just been it's gone hand in hand with the lifestyle for me for my entire career. And, it really hit a point, bottom line, it really hit a point for me, about 7 years ago when I was having some trouble at home, and that trouble was definitely, I want to make this really clear too, just for getting this part of my story out, but
go ahead.
Here's the bottom line of what I believe and where I'm at in my recovery is, alcoholism, for those that, argue about it being a disease or not a disease, I don't like to get involved in that argument because I know that both sides have valid points to the the actuality of it being a disease. But what I can say that for me, it is a disease, but what I believe is it's a disease of the spirit. And by that, I mean, yes, it comes down to, people say, no, it comes down to someone's will or their willpower. And I believe that too. It comes down to someone's choices and will. But the why I believe it's a disease still is because if your ability to actually process right and wrong and healthy boundaries for yourself and others is warped and tainted, which it becomes that way when you're drinking and using on a regular basis, it's inevitable that it becomes that way, then it is a disease, but it's a disease of the spirit and the mind. And then eventually the deeper you go, then it can become a disease that actually affects the body. I remember the first time, and I'll just be really blunt, I remember the first time that I actually physically knew I had a problem, and that was when the very first time that I clearly remember waking up in a hotel. I was on tour. This was about 2011. I was on tour with an act at the time, other than Tears for Fears, and it was summertime, and I had been partying quite heavy the night before. Didn't go to bed till about 5 a.m. Woke up at about 9, so only having fallen asleep for about 4 hours, and realizing that my body was not well because, again, through that 4.5-5 hours of sleep, I had begun to, burn off the alcohol that I had had. Right. And so when I woke up, I realized I was shaking. My heart was pounding really rapidly. I had the sweats, felt kind of nauseous. And without even really thinking about it, my thought was, and it was just my body telling my mind what it needed. But my thought was, I need a drink. And there was nothing in the hotel left because I had drank all the mini bar clean. So I went down to the bus, our tour bus, which had been parked in the summertime without, so when the bus stops for the night and they turn off the generators and stuff, I open the bus and walk in, and it's about 120 inside that bus. And I walk in and there was no cold beer. So here I am grabbing a beer that was just in the cupboards that was probably close to 120 as well. And a definitely warm shot of Jack Daniels. And I remember gulping down that shot and then cracking that beer and it burning my throat because it was alcohol, but because it was so hot temperature wise. But doing that shot and guzzling this hot beer and walking out of the bus, lighting a cigarette, taking about 10 steps and feeling that that change in my metabolism, feeling that that the smoothing out, so to speak, of where then the shakes kind of stopped and I relaxed, my heartbeat kind of calmed down. I finished my smoke and I went up to my hotel room, and I remember walking in, sitting on my bed, looking around the room, realizing, wow, I'm buzzed again. And now I feel calm, and actually thinking, holy shit. Like now I'm in for it. Like if this is the cycle, if it's gotten to this point physically, but yet oddly enough, I still had another, however many weeks of touring, bottom line is the recognition of me having a problem and me actually arriving at a point of doing something about it still came quite a few years later. And it was a very, very turbulent and tumultuous few years until the point of really making a decision. And in recovery, they call it the gift of desperation. I had acknowledged that I had a problem, but I really truly hadn't hit for me, what I call a spiritual bottom, a place where I just realized I cannot do this anymore. If I want to be alive, bottom line. So That's where it took me. And again, through that, lots of damage to personal relationships. My marital relationships fell apart. Family relationships, very strained and broken relationships with my children. The whole gamut, run-ins with the law. This brought me to a point in 2014, which is when this all really kind of came to a head. Although I still went, bottom line, I got arrested 3 times in 1 week in 2014, all related to alcohol. Yeah. Which again, I share that openly and honestly. And even then, Jackie, even after the effects of the run-ins with the law, DUI, losing my license, all of this kind of stuff, losing the place I lived, I still did not get sober for another 9 months. So shows you the will, when you talk about willpower, shows you the willpower I had to keep fighting, thinking that I didn't have a problem or that I could somehow, it was just going to automatically kind of stabilize or fix itself, which without honest to God help, in recovery, it wasn't going to. And that's when I look at and go, for my personal opinion on it being a disease, mm-hmm. that I needed help. I needed help other than what I could provide for myself. And that's where the program of recovery and my belief in a higher power came in. So,
Jamie, let me ask you a question. It's a 2-part question. My curiosity. Uh-huh. When Jamie, and God bless you, brother, in this recovery situation, and may it be a lifelong situation, but I have to ask you a question that's going to be, to me, it's just common knowledge, or maybe even just, maybe right up front. When you, or I'm assuming your bandmates are 100%, 1,000% behind your recovery, obviously.
Definitely.
And that's the principles of the band and also your bandmates. But I have to ask this other side of the question, because it's been immortalized in movies and so on and so forth. But is Jamie a bummer now when you walk into a backstage area or in your, and you know where I'm going with this itself. Nobody wants to, oh my God, Jamie's in recovery. Mm-hmm. How do you feel when you're sitting around people who don't know you? Obviously they're not going to put away a beer or a glass of wine or a shot glass.
Yeah.
But how do you deal with that? I mean, especially with your bandmates, let's forget about the bandmates. Let's talk about when you're in a situation, how mm-hmm. real is that struggle for you to do? I mean, do you walk out of the room? Do you just find a higher power? How do you stay away from just that one drink?
I think that's
how do you stay away from that?
No, man, I think that's a really honest and straightforward and really necessary question that a lot of times people ask. And I try and make it as simple as possible. And this is, mm-hmm. I'm not, by no means do I want to stand like I'm on a soapbox for any specific recovery thing or whatever. I don't like to do that. I'm a member of an anonymous program. That's all I can say. And the bottom line is this, is what I have learned and come to realize is how I do it is it's based on two things. And the first thing is what is considered or explained to me that I've learned is a maintenance of my spiritual condition. And by that, I mean, mm-hmm. if I'm doing some very simple things that are explained for me and have been explained for me to do every day, literally upon first awakening, setting my thought process straight and reminding myself of two things. Number one, that there is something greater than me that I can turn stuff over to. And number two, that if I can work on acceptance, which is accepting no matter what the stress is, right. No matter what the thing that comes at me at any given moment of the day, I have the ability to restart my day emotionally at any given point, you know?
Jamie, I'm going to stop you right there. I'm going to interrupt you right now. We got 5 seconds. So I want to pick this up on this next segment. I got to give it to the higher power, and that's the CEO of the corporation. So we're going to walk away from segment number 3-2 into number 3 with my in-studio guest, Jamie Wollam. Guys, Jackie Bertone, Jackie's Groove, Inner Talk Radio. Don't go anywhere. Much more to talk about. Stay tuned.
Hi, this is Tim Dolbear, host of Sound Experience here on InterTalk Radio. And Source Connect by Source Element is the essential tool that we use to link between my studio in Austin, Texas, and the WS radio station in San Diego. Now, with Source Connect, not only can we communicate in real time and with HD audio, but it's synced up and is of a high enough quality that I can use it for real-time ADR work, remote recording and overdubbing, and it even allows me to remotely control a DAW. Source Connect by Source Element, affordable, high-quality audio and video connection over the internet for all of your production needs.
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on Inner Talk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
Make this your vinyl night. I'm John J.R. Robinson, and every week, music creation comes alive through stories, experiences, and sounds when vinyl records filled our hearts and minds. My friends and I share our tips and techniques used in creation of iconic tracks for recording artists such as Michael Jackson, Eric Clapton, Quincy Jones, and Steve Winwood, to name a few. Vinyl has emerged hot, and the soul of vinyl defines art and passion, which burns deepest at night. Tune in every Wednesday.
Are you serious about their music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.
Welcome to Jackie's Groove. Come journey with us through the rhythm of the music business with your host, Jackie Bertone.
Not to date myself, man, but that goes all the way back to, I believe, and Jamie will correct me, I think 1984, when that became, of course, a worldwide anthem, a song called Shout, with my in-studio guest, Mr. Jamie Wollam. Jamie,
yes,
welcome
sir.
Back, brother. Segment number three. Jamie, you know, that red light that was flashing on my face a little while ago, I so regrettably had to interrupt you, but you know, for the listeners out there that are in the struggle or in recovery, Jamie's pick it up again. Let's start with the steps again and how it is to how your maintenance is working on this. Just act like we just started again on this.
Yeah, no, I appreciate it. I think what I was saying, and just to really quickly revisit what you had asked me, was, you know, that is it difficult? Do I find it difficult? How do I find being sober in the business and, you know, around the scene? You know, with others drinking it, being readily around, mm-hmm. How do I handle that? And how do I sort of cope with that? And where I went with it is just what I've learned is that, again, it's two things that are the most important. Number one is literally, for those that think this is a cliche, it is a cliche, but it's truth. So if it's a true cliche, if that makes sense, but literally, it's one day at a time for me. I do the same thing. I literally look at it this way, and I know people might gasp at the extremity of what I'm saying, but if they'll let me get to the end of the point, and that is that I make no bones about it. I am an alcoholic. The bottom line is there's a very good chance. Odds are I may get shit-faced drunk tomorrow or a week from now. Those are pretty good odds based on my past that I'm.
Let's pray that doesn't happen, brother.
Exactly. So my point is, so this is why I'm saying that people might gasp and go, what? But here's what I do know is that I didn't drink yesterday because the first thing that I did when I woke up before I even my feet hit the ground is I take a moment to reflect, to get in touch with my higher power. And I ask that my thought life, my thought process be set in the right place. And by that, those things are to be of love, to be of service, and to be out of self-pity and self-doubt. And when I start my day with that and really kind of get in tune with that very quickly, that gets me headed in the right direction. What I am promised and what I believe is that I'm given what's called a daily reprieve. I'm given the ability to be free of that, those chains one day at a time. And so my point is, when I say odds are I might get absolutely shit-faced tomorrow, my point is I don't worry about tomorrow yet because all I have and all I have to focus on is today. What I do know is that tomorrow morning when I wake up, if I do what I did today to stay sober, then it's 100% guarantee that I won't drink tomorrow either. As long as when tomorrow becomes my today, that's when I approach it. Does that make sense?
Amen, brother. Yeah, of course. And you know what?
Yeah.
There's so much, Jamie, to be thankful for. Again, too, you know, you and I have been chopping it up on the phone, you know, in the last week and a half, and there's certain people that you meet in life and you feel like you've known these people, not just because we're brothers in music, but there's just that certain vibe and understanding what's going on. Nobody understands survival and recovery and just to be, you know, overwhelmed with love and joy more than I do, you know, and other than my beautiful wife of 30 going on 34 years, Caprice,
I'm
very thankful for. Yeah, man, you know, it works. And I'm thankful also for one of our very good friends that I was blown out of the water that we were mutual friends. One of my dearest friends, our dearest friends, is my girl, my sister, Jackie Stone. And Jackie's the one that actually introduced you and I together. And you will. And I know Jackie's listening right now. So, Jackie, I'm going to go there. Jackie, absolutely, as gorgeous as she is, she's musically crippled. Because the bottom line is when she mentioned the fact that she knows the drummer from Tears for Fears, I said, Jackie, do you even know who Tears for Fears is? And she goes, I think I do. You know, and it's like it's every time we're out. We were out a couple days ago and there was something at the Yard House, music playing. Caprice, my wife, points up to this speaker and she goes, Jackie, you know who that is? And it was a song called Oyo Como Va by my good friend Santana. And she goes, I know that song. That's the reggae group Santana. So, you know, so Jackie, I love you, sweetheart. Just stay with what you do in the veterinary field.
Love
all going to be. And also, too, you know, we have some mutual friends in common, an amazing group coming up on Jackie's Groove, hopefully in the next few weeks, a group called Venice. And if you guys are not, the listeners out there don't know who Venice is, they are definitely a cult band. You know, it's the, you know, the kids of the Lennon sisters and the Ants, and there's Marky and there's Michael and there's Kip and there's Mark Harris and you know, and who is on drums, and then my good friend Rich Man Giancaro, who plays percussion every once in a while with them. That's where you got your start on. That's how I met Venice, and that's how I met you, was through Jackie. Yeah. So Jackie, thank you, my friend. Thank you. Now
thank you,
let me
Jackie.
Ask you this question. Let's ask you this question, good looking.
Yeah.
I gave you some homework.
Yeah.
Over the last couple of days.
Yep.
And, you know, again, with all the tunes. Now, for everybody else out there who are worldwide Tears fans, you know, I'm a fan with it because if anybody who sits there and employs these monkeys called percussionists, God bless your heart. But on these songs, it seems like all their hits are laden with percussion, congas, shakers, tambourine, bells, blocks, and so on. And what I'm going to do right now, I'm going to play one of my favorite songs. We don't have this queued up, but I do through the miracle of studios here at the home. Let's talk. This is one of my favorite songs. Give me 1 second here, Jamie.
Yeah.
Advice for the young at heart. Soon we will be older. When we're gonna make it.
Everybody, Tears for Fears, a live advice for the young at heart. Listen to this groove. All right. I had to time that out, Jamie, because I don't want to pay any royalties on that.
Yeah, of course.
But,
I gotcha.
But that song, one of my favorites, Advice for the Young at Heart, did you do your homework and did you find out who was on the percussion chair during those sessions?
Well, here's where I'm at with that. And again, I hoped we were going to get to this at some point. The bottom line is this. I failed at my homework miserably to the extent of the fact that I could not find and I haven't had – I know that Kurt – Roland lives in England, so being the fact that we're on different time zones and whatever, I sent an email there and I'm but no, here's – I don't know who played on Advice for the Young at Heart. I don't know if you can help me with that or if that was the reason I was supposed to do my homework, but I could not find anything.
That's the reason why, yeah. I couldn't either. I mean
– I couldn't either. And the one thing that I do know, although I'm looking oddly enough – what I think I've come to understand, and I believe this, but this is something I'm going to leave up to you, is that I know that two guys that have been monstrously instrumental in the rhythm sections of songs from the Big Chair, mm-hmm. Seeds of Love and Elemental were Chris Hughes, who also produced those two records. And my point is, I think – and I don't think I'm too far off, but a great deal of the percussion was actually programmed. It was MIDI sequenced and programmed. I think, though, I also do know that what I did find out is that Jerry Murata played percussions sporadically through both of those albums, through songs from The Big Chair and Seeds of Love. So,
No one's going to make money off this contest. I just kind of want to just know from my own situation because I can't figure it out. I can listen to percussionists and I can usually tell who is playing just by their styling and so on and so forth. But that's something we'll go on, you know. But let's stay on the Tears for Fears wagon here for a second. Share,
yeah, of course.
If you would, my brother, share where were you and when was this that you got that call to join the band?
Yeah, I happily. And I wish it was something that seems much more, for me, it was still, I equate it to scratching off a winning number on a lottery ticket. Although the interesting correlation to that is that I wasn't doing anything monumental toward pursuing it or anything. I'll tell you real briefly. I had played with a number of different artists to some level of acclaim, you know, being raised in LA and being on the scene for years, but, hadn't really gotten to that kind of level, but I had worked with, and it's really, really simple. The other guitar player in Tears for Fears, who's been a member of the band for going on about 12 years now, is an amazing musician by the name of Charlton Pettis, who's also a producer, songwriter. He actually co-produced Tears' last studio record, which is called Everybody Loves a Happy Ending. Amazing, amazing record. And he has been in the band for, like I said, about 12 years, and he's known Kurt for years. They played together back in New York, and so as a producer, Charlton had gotten in contact with me to play drums on some other records that he had produced. So we got introduced via mutual musician friends, and this was about 4 or 5 years. I've known Charlton going on 15 years now, so this was about 5, 6 years before the Tears thing even came about. I would just go do lots of sessions at Charlton's studio for things he was producing. And there was another drummer by the name of Nick DiVirgilio, who's quite an accomplished drummer in and of his own right, who had been playing with Tears since Kurt and Roland got back together, because they were separated for many, many years as well. I didn't know if – I'm sure you knew that or whatever, but they had just gotten back together and had done this record called Everybody Loves a Happy Ending, and Nick DiVirgilio was touring with them. And so I knew Charlton. I knew that he played in the band, and I just came and did lots of sessions for Charlton. And then one day, late 2009, I was driving. Oddly enough, I remember exactly where I was. I was in my car driving to a band rehearsal up in Hollywood at about 2 p.m, and my phone rang, and it was Charlton. And I answered, just assuming he was calling me again to book me for another drum tracking session at his studio. And he said, "Hey, what are you doing?" And I said, "Just heading to a rehearsal. What's going on?" He goes, "No, I mean, what are you doing in general?" And I'm like, "Just driving to a rehearsal, man." And he goes, "Well, any chance you're interested in playing with Tears for Fears?" And I swear on my heart, hand on heart, I thought he was just pulling my chain and joking with me. And I'm like, come on, what do you, he goes, no, seriously, there's a conflict of schedule and they've got some shows booked. And unfortunately, Nick DiVirgilio isn't able to make it. And they talked to me about it. And I said, I know just the guy. And part of the reason, and this is an odd side note, but gets into the music part. Part of the reason why it was, why I was thrown into the hat so quickly and then subsequently not even having to audition or do anything was Nick was carried a lot of background vocals as well in the band. So they needed a drummer that sang. And Charlton knew from me working on other sessions with him that I sang and was a, you know, songwriter, played and multi-instrumentalist is what I guess I'm trying to get at. But he knew that I sang. And so he said, I know just the guy. So he asked me if I'd be interested. And I said, yeah, I mean, of course, give me a break. And so literally within another week or so, I received an email from Roland. And then I got a file with about 25 songs to review, along with a live recording that had the drums and Nick's vocal parts sort of highlighted or bumped up in the mix, so I could really get the live arrangements and the parts that he sang. And then I was at a rehearsal about 6 weeks later, actually walking in, meeting these guys for the first time and playing these iconic songs for the first time, only to then hit the road to Australia and South America and stuff a week later. So it was pretty fast and pretty mind-blowing, you know? But that's how literally it came. It came from Charlton Pettis, who is still the other guitar player in the band.
You know, and that's amazing because you are going on 7.5 years, aren't you?
Yeah. Yeah. My first gig with Tears was March 10th of 2010. So it's just been over 7 years.
It's amazing, man. You know, especially in a situation too, where on most bands, I mean, one of my dear friends, Tony Lindsay, mm-hmm. who was the vocalist with a small group called Santana for 24 years. I asked him, and he just lost his gig to a lot of the guys a year ago, December. And mm-hmm. I said to Tony, share with the listeners out there, you know, the relevance of being relevant, staying relevant. And what his response was, I think, was pretty prolific. He said, you know what? I don't ever get comfortable where I'm at.
Yeah.
You know, and that, I mean, 24 years singing those songs worldwide, but he never got comfortable. And I think that's probably a wise situation because, you know, with all of our mutual friends, you know, Tris Imboden, you know, who's been with Chicago for 27 years, you know, you look at all the guys that have been around for a long time. But again, too, in one of our dearest friends, your friend, my friend, Todd Sirkerman.
Yeah,
I mean, Todd right now is going 21 years with the band called Styx.
Yeah.
Still in a situation where he's not overly comfortable. When he was on maternity leave with his baby, Tegan, who now is over, I think she's going to be 3 and with Taylor. And Kenny Ornoff actually subbed for him for a week. Mm-hmm. That was really hard for him to walk away from that, man, because you don't know if you're going to be welcome back. Well, obviously, he knows he's cemented with that band. But again, things can change dramatically tomorrow. And what's changing right now, my dear friend, is that we're changing out of segment number 3 into segment number 4. The first hour is blown by with my in-studio guest, my new friend, Mr. Jamie Wollam. And Jamie, guess what? I don't know how in the hell this woman even got in my studio right now, but Jamie, come here. Put your mouth over here.
Hi, Jamie. It's Jackie.
Jackie's here, baby girl.
And Jackie.
Dad, she's yelling back at you.
Hi, honey.
So we're going to back on the second thing. No, you can't see her. You have no idea what I'm looking at right now, my brother.
Good to see your voice in my ear.
Good to see your voice in the ear. Exactly. So, Jamie, let's pick this up, man. Let's get a little bit deeper into the business when we come back on segment number 4.
Absolutely.
Out of a 2-hour interview with this amazing man. They're openly and honest and an open book. It's called Jamie Wollam. Jamie, go to the bathroom, get yourself something to drink. I know I'm going to do so. So with that said, guys, don't go anywhere. Jackie Bertone, Jackie's Groove, brought to you by InterTalk Radio with my in-studio guest, iconic rock drummer with Tears for Fears, Mr. Jamie Wollam. Don't go anywhere. Stay tuned.
This is Jackie Bertone from Jackie's Groove. Come join me weekly on my journey through the music business as I take you behind the velvet rope, interviewing industry notables such as Al Di Meola, Michael McDonald, and Al Jarreau, to name but a few. Listen to their stories on being in the studios recording number one hits and onto the stages throughout the globe. Allow me to be your music historian. You can hear me live every Monday at 2 p.m. and every Wednesday at 12 noon Pacific Standard Time or 24/7 on jackiesgroove.com. Ready to get your groove on?
Hi, this is Tim Dolbear from Eclectica Studios. I'm a full-time mixing and recording engineer. I work with Grammy winners, labels, and indie artists. Using state-of-the-art digital mixing and restoration tools and the very best in analog gear. Really, though, it's my ability to bring tracks to life and fulfill your vision for your music. This has made me sought after by producers and artists worldwide. So spend your time working on music and not chasing a mix down a rabbit hole. Go to timdolbear.com and check out our free one song mix offer.
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on InterTalk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
Are you serious about your music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.
EnterTalk Radio, you're in to all things music.
Welcome to Jackie's Groove. Come journey with us through the rhythm of the music business with your host, Jackie Bertone.
Text, Tino.
And I'll be the wind that blows, the one who knows your every move. I'm the time, I am the ghost.
Everybody, welcome back to Jackie's Groove. This is Jackie Bertone. We're in segment number four, brought to you by InterTalk Radio with my in-studio guest, Mr. Jamie Wollam. And, I gotta tell you something, Jamie. Are you back on the line? I know we both had to use the labanyo just now.
I am here.
Good. You know, it's so weird. On that song, that was brought to me about 2.5-3 years ago. I don't remember who the production company was, but they brought this tune in, and actually, it was 2 years ago, and I loved it so much. I laid shaker. This is straight shaker down on it, and then when our aforementioned friend Jackie and I played that song for her. She goes, oh my gosh, because that's Jamie. And I go, Jamie who? And then that's how we met each other. So what was the genesis of that song and whatever happened to that? And how much did it make its way around the industry?
Well, I think it made its way. First of all, thank you for the kind words about it. And it's oddly enough, and I know you know this too, but it's such a big industry in regards to how stuff gets around and gets used and whatever. That's a whole nut. That's a 4-hour talk show subject another time. But bottom line is within the very first maybe 6 months of starting to write music for myself or for potentially not even really knowing what I wanted to do, just knowing I wanted to actually express something from inside out on into music. I got together with a really good friend of mine named Daniel Kalischer, Dan Kalischer, who's an amazing musician, guitar player in and of his own right. And we were a session guy as well, kind of similar to me. And we got together to write one day, and it just came out. It had been inspired. I'll just tell the story real briefly. It had been inspired musically. Please. It was inspired by I'm a big fan of Alison Krauss and Union Station. And it had been inspired by a song that was at the ending credits of a movie called Get Low, which was with Robert Duvall and Bill Murray and stuff, kind of a little underground movie that was very, very kind of old school country vibe, kind of Oh Brother Where Art Thou, very, very, but not quite as happy campy as some of that stuff, just a little darker and more somber. And so that I'd seen that movie and been really touched by it. And again, that song was written at a point, and I'll just be straight up, where things were really, really, it's amazing how some really fantastic music, it's odd how life works that way, but some of the most beautiful, heartfelt music can come out of some of the times that are the darkest in your life, you know? But I'm thankful that songwriting was a channel for me to express a lot of stuff that I really didn't have any other way to express it, you know? So I had written that song. So Dan and I got together and it really, it came together in about 45 minutes. So we just started, I had a little bit of a progression that he picked up on, and being a much more skilled guitar player kind of helped me, you know, musically work out the framework. And then I had expressed to him what I wanted the song to be about, which was just, again, not to get dark on it, it was just some really dark stuff, thinking, you know, I've never gotten to a place where I felt like I would ever have. And again, I'm just going to touch real lightly on this because I know I'm not here to pull up some heavy duty roots of stuff. But never have I had the specific feeling that I wanted to end my life. But I tell you that, because I never had the balls, to be honest with you. And the bottom line is that. But there's a fine line between actually going through, you know, carrying out or even going to the point of conceptualizing something like ending your life because you just feel like things are so dark. But I can tell you many mornings when my eyes opened, I can communicate the feeling that I didn't want to wake up. I didn't have the balls to do anything to actually bring that to fruition. But I can just tell you how many mornings I woke up and just did not want to wake up.
I think people would be lying and interject if they said they didn't do that. I mean, God, I'm thankful for life every single day of the week, but there's times and a thing called depression that kind of eats its way into our brain, regardless of what it is. Then all of a sudden when your eyes do open and when you see, you know, little Bailey looking at you and giving you kisses, then you think to yourself, how fucking selfish could I have been to even think about that? You know, and then you got to think about this also. Again, we have crosses we have to bear, and I have a very good friend of mine that is very, 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 very much in the struggle with deep depression. And I pray for him and I work with him on a regular basis, you know, through the miracle of FDA drugs and so on and so forth that help kind of take the edge off. But, you know, that's no joke, brother. I mean, it's a situation where, you know, when you think about that, then all of a sudden you look in the mirror, you throw some water on your face or slap the shit out of you yourself and go, what the fuck was I thinking, man? Where was I going with this? But the fact is, and I hate to use that term, the struggle is real, but it is. It every day, but I say this, Jamie, every day we wake up and there's no dirt on top of us. It's a good fucking day, brother. Amen. It's a good day, man.
Amen. You know, I was just going to say, I think for me that the things that managed to become a turnabout for me was the fact that if I can spend half the time that I used to spend, or will find myself leaning towards spending, looking at negative. Mm-hmm. If I can spend half that time looking for things to be grateful for in my life, and which, when I say being of service, doing things to help another human being will takes you out of yourself. Because bottom line is, whether it's dealing with dealing with self-pity or self-deprecation or woe is me, what I've come to learn too is that is based in the same thing that being incredibly arrogant or egotistical is. It's just the opposite side of the scale. To me, it's all still based in what's called my own ego. And because bottom line, it's all about me, whether it's look at how badass I am, it's all about me. Or if it's, wow, look at how shitty my life is and how fucked up this is. And look at all the mistakes I've made. Guess what? It's still all about me, isn't it? Right. And what helps keep me out of myself is doing things for others and not getting caught is sort of what I've learned, is being of service, doing things to be. And that helps keep me out of my own self, which is the best place for me, is out of my own self, you know?
You know, and it's funny, we talked about that before, you know, again, being on the road. I said this in the first part of the conversation about being in a world famous band like Tears for Fears and touring the world and all the groups that I've been blessed to work with and so on, where I don't know, I can't speak for you, but I think by this point, I know your vibe. I don't like it when people's noses are up my ass. I really don't like that, just for the fact of the matter, because I think a majority of people out there are paid to do so. Yeah. And, you know, and we're on there. But the thing is, when you're out there and you're being picked up and you're being chauffeured and you're being staying in a five-star hotel and everybody that's around you pointing fingers and, oh, my God, this is the guys and, you know, blah, blah, blah. But the thing is, we can get that way. And then we get home and we get on a plane and we get to the house and we open the door and we say hi to our plants and we say hi to the furniture. And then we say hi to the dog shit in the backyard. And my wife is looking at me and she says to me, hi, honey. And I'm no longer Jackie Bertone, and Jamie Wollam is no longer Jamie Wollam. We become the name Hey You.
Yeah, yeah.
Because they're not impressed. They are impressed, but God forbid they should ever show us that they are our fan. Also, yeah. So the fact that, you know, they are the grounders. You know, they are the ones that keep us humble. Because in this industry, I wasn't always humble, man. I was a little prick. I was working with Tower of Power when I was 19 years old. Yeah. You know, you couldn't tell me my shit didn't stink. Then I had someone tell me a long time ago that my shit did stink, and I stopped with the ego years ago. So, and I'm forever thankful for everybody else. I'm forever thankful for the cool brothers and sisters that we met in this industry. And it's funny when you think about it, we go back, you know, you and I have a lot of people, friends in common, you know, we're very, very thankful for everything that's been bestowed on us. You know, I want to ask you a question.
Sure.
And I neglected to ask you this in the beginning itself. But all the people that, you know, that you've inspired, and let's go back for a second. Who's inspired Jamie? Jamie, I walked into the Wollam household years ago when we were both youngins growing up. Mm-hmm. Now I'm going to draw a picture for you, and also all the old fucks out there. Listen to this.
Yeah.
What was coming out of the huge stereo console? That's when the 33 and a third record player was on top. Two big speakers covered by some funky ass wool. And a TV in the middle of it. What were we listening to at the Wollam's household? What was coming through those speakers musically?
Well, I'll tell you this. This might lose you or some of the listeners, but I don't think so, because I can keep it really, really broad, but applicable. Because this does tie into the uniqueness of me playing drums with Tears for Fears, and I wanted to touch on that for a moment too.
Please.
If you walked into my house when I was 14, 15, between that age and maybe 20, before I went to PIT. And again, you hit it on the head, the 33 and a third record, which is when I was playing to music, I literally had a turntable back behind my drum set that I had to put on blankets and pads because the rumble of the drums would make the record skip if I played too hard. Right. So I had to put it on pads and stuff to keep it from skipping, and plug headphones into it. And I just would play to records aside from the lessons that I was taking, but my general practice time was playing to albums constantly. And if you looked at the stack of records that was behind my drum set, it was so not related to music like Tears for Fears. I was a hard rock, heavy metal drummer from the get go. And so that being said, you would see me listening to and playing to, AC/DC. So Phil Rudd was one of my all-time idols, Iron Maiden, Judas Priest, Ozzy Osbourne, Black Sabbath, Scorpions, Deep Purple, UFO, all of the, and again, I never, then people go, oh, Metallica, Motorhead. Unfortunately, and I respect all those bands. I never got really harder music than about Judas Priest, because I still always, and I think this is why I got into writing songs later, but I still always needed to have there be a melody, like a hook, a melody vocally. And even Rob Halford, who's an amazing singer, those songs always still had melody to it. Once it got to where it got any heavier, where it was kind of more like, voice scratchy, I got lost and I couldn't do, and it still had to have sort of a mid-tempo beat. So again, influences on me as far as drumming goes too, I can tell you to this day, my all-time favorite and always will be is John Bonham. Like that to me is the epitome of where I will ever want to reach as a musician, is to be able to play with that kind of feel, and just to geek out music for a minute.
Think about hold on for a second. Think about all the people that we know in common, all the great players like John J.R. Robinson. All the people. Think about, and I've been blown away by all the people, all the drummers / percussionists that have been on the show. And oddly enough, it just shows you the power of a company called Drum Workshop, which you are a proud endorser of, and as they now are the principal company behind my company called LP Music, that I've been with 27 years. You know, the stuff they do, you know, the Don Lombardis and the John Goods and the Derek Zimmermans and everybody else, you know, I love those guys. In fact, I know they love you. Instead of me telling you how much they love you, why don't you go ahead? Florentino, is our mutual friend, Mr. John Good, on the line right now?
Oh, John.
John, say hi to Jamie. Jamie, say hi to John.
John, I am beyond surprised, honored, and just over the moon that you took the time to call in right now. This is blowing my mind.
I'm asleep on the couch right now. And, you know, and Jackie, who I dearly love, and we're just like, you know,
right back
brothers from a long time, he said, "Hey, look, Jamie's going to be on the show." And I said, "I can't miss that.
Come on, man.
You know, I got too many stories to tell about Jamie." So
yes.
Here we are, Pally.
Please, I don't know. I don't even, if there's anything you could impart to anybody that's listening, that's a story about me, good or bad, I would be, I mean, that's how crazy this is. Good or bad, I would love for you to impart something. Could you?
Oh, okay. Okay. Let me tell you one thing.
Okay.
I basically went to the bottom of Lake Superior to find this wood, this incredible 700-year-old wood, right, for my, I forget what anniversary, because I'm getting so damn old. Mm-hmm. And we just had our 45th, but, and I had this, my personal kit.
Yep.
And you were playing with Venice, I think, right?
Yep.
At the time.
Yep.
And, you know, and I love those Venice boys, but I found out that I loved you a little bit more. And
dig it.
Because I love the way you play. I love the way you explain your musical, the meaning, you know, that you have with what's going on with your the way you deliver your music, the way you deliver yourself to everything.
Yeah.
And, you know, you and I have had such a great, I don't know, connection. It's been fantastic for all these years, but I am pissed off.
Okay.
That you took my kit.
Yes.
My personal kit. My personal Lake Superior drum set, because I gave it to you.
Yep.
But you know what? It's yours. It's not mine. It'll be yours till the end of time. You know, and your kids will have it. And but anyway, that's the only pissed offness.
I have to impose something on that story if I can for 2 seconds. I remember the day that I walked in to meet John. I can't even tell you how it was like all of my Christmas mornings combined into one. The elation and it was like Charlie walking into the chocolate factory and meeting Gene Wilder and getting a tour of Wonka's behind the scenes. It was beyond. And then when I sat with John after getting a tour of seeing how these drums were made and the love and the care and the detail, it was mind blowing. And then to be asked to be a part of the family, I can't even tell you. And that day I remember saying to John, I was getting ready to leave to go out. I had some upcoming gigs right away with Venice and getting ready to go on the road with them. And I remember, you know, is there something? And he said, "Well, here, I want you to take this kit." And he bestowed upon me a drum set that, again, all I can put into words, it's the most beautiful kit I've ever laid my eyes on. The detail on this drum set is incredible. It was made like John
Jamie,
said.
Jamie, I'm going to stop you right here. I'm going to stop you real quick. John, do me a favor. Can I impose on you just to hang out for another couple of minutes so we go to a break and come back? Because the listeners are loving this right now. So can I just impose on you just to hang out for the next break and come back on so we can talk a little bit more about DW and Jamie's relationship? Is that okay?
Yeah, we're going to commercial, right?
Yeah, we're going to commercial. We'll be right back in like 2 minutes. So guys, don't go anywhere. Jackie Bertone, Jackie's Groove, with my in-studio guest, Jamie Wollam, and the Vice President of Drum Workshop, Mr. John Good. Don't go anywhere, guys. We'll be right back on segment number 5.
Are you serious about your music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on InterTalk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
Hi, I'm Tim Dolbear, the host of Sound Experience on InterTalk Radio. Each week, I talk with top professional audio engineers, producers, musicians, and the manufacturers that make the tools that we use in the studio each and every day. From capturing the perfect take to mastering your final release, and the tools and how the pros use them, we are going to dive deep into their process and learn from their experience. I look forward to you joining us each week on Sound Experience with me, your host, Tim Dolbear.
Make this your vinyl night. I'm John J.R. Robinson, and every week, music creation comes alive through stories, experiences, and sounds when vinyl records filled our hearts and minds. My friends and I share our tips and techniques used in creation of iconic tracks for recording artists such as Michael Jackson, Eric Clapton, Quincy Jones, and Steve Winwood, to name a few. Vinyl has emerged hot, and the soul of vinyl defines art and passion, which burns deepest at night. Tune in every Wednesday at 2 p.m. Pacific Standard Time on
Groove. Come journey with us through the rhythm of the music business with your host, Jackie Bertone.
And trying to broaden our horizons as to what we listen to.
We were also, you know, sort of losing a little bit of our sort of shoegazing early 80s electronic edge. And we were actually starting to listen to, believe it or not, Bruce Springsteen, born in the USA. And just becoming acutely aware of huge sounding records. There was also Trevor Horn, who was just kicking everyone's backside. You know, with the sonic qualities of stuff of the Fairlight. So we were like, okay, we got to do something.
This next song is called Head Over Heels.
But you know what I'm head over heels about? I'm head over heels, man, that I'm having such an amazing interview today with my new musical brother. Feels like we've been around together for a lifetime. And that's Mr. Jamie Wollam, from the drummer from Tears for Fears, and a song called Head Over Heels. You know, I was just going to say, and I said at the break, you know, we're all thankful for everything that's around us and so on. But I got to tell you, what keeps our ship afloat and keeps us moving forward is our sponsors, people that stand behind and believe in InterTalk Radio and Jackie's Groove. And with that said, I got to say thank you to my company called LP Music. I've gone on 27 years as a proud endorser with them. And also, too, as I said earlier, The company that came in and saved LP is a small drum company out of Oxnard, California called Drum Workshop. And I'd say that with tongue in cheek. And with that said, they hosted InterTalk Radio. I think it was like mid-year last year in 2016, in which John Good took the time and took us around and showed us how these masterful drums are put together. And with that said, please welcome back to the show, Jamie Wollam, and also Mr. John Good. You guys, let's pick up where we left off. Welcome back.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. So Jamie.
Yes. So I had to finish this brief story about when I went and saw John for the first time. I was just completely blown away, mesmerized. Felt like I was on it. It was the equivalent of if I walked on the moon. That's how blown away I was at what I was seeing. And John asked me if I would like to be a part of the DW family, which of course I think I said yes before he had even finished the sentence. But bottom line is I needed a kit, and John said, I got something for you, pal. Let's how about this kit? And he showed me and gave me his own personal kit that was built from this Lake Superior wood called, I know it to be called timeless timber. It was from the Edmund Fitzgerald.
That's what it was.
And I still have that kit. It was my first kit from DW. I cherish it. And the funny part is that I signed with DW in early part of 2001. So I'm going on my 16th year with them, and I've had a few other kits that I've had made or that I've gotten from DW that I've used. And funny little story is every time I go back to John and we talk about something for a kit for a project or that I'm doing, his first response is that first kit not good enough? And I always laugh because there will be no kit that is ever that good. So he has set the bar beyond anything that could ever be duplicated. But bottom line is the support, the support, the love for the craft, the love for music and the love. John's got one of the biggest hearts of any human being I've ever met personally. And he's taught me a great deal about John has taught me a great deal about how to be professional and yet how to be humble. And there is a big difference between a lot of people that think they know what that really means. But John is a living example of what it means to be the epitome of professional towards your craft and what you do and incredible work ethic toward those things. Yet can walk around that factory and call everybody by their first name, treat them like they are, treat every human being as though they are deserving of, what they have, and is an incredible, one of the most giving human beings I've ever met. So I can't say enough good things. And I'm just, again, honored that you took the time to call in, John. Thank you.
John, let me
jump in.
Yeah. I swear to God, Jackie talked to me about this, and he says, you're going to be around. And I go, for him, you're damn right.
Absolutely.
It's the world.
I love you, Jamie. Yeah. We hung out about, I don't know, 3 weeks ago, something like that.
Yeah.
And we put together a drum kit, and we're making it right now. Mm-hmm. And all the guys are so excited because you've got that enthusiasm. You've got that sparkle in your eye. Mm-hmm. All these miles down the road that a lot of guys just don't have, or they take for granted, or whatever the hell it is, right? Jackie, you know what I'm talking about?
Absolutely, man.
So sometimes it's like, some people expect things.
Yeah.
Jamie never expects things. He comes and he humbly goes, boy, I'm doing this project and it's going to be a pretty good size one. And this one, Jamie, is impressive. It's pretty cool.
Hey John, what DW did for Wally Wilfredo and his 50th anniversary for Chicago's Congas, and also for Triss's 50th anniversary drums for Chicago. Brilliant. Absolutely brilliant. It's emblazoned. If you guys get a chance, I don't know if John's got it up on DW's website, but you can go to Tris Simboden from Chicago and Wilfredo Reyes Jr. and take a look at what DW and LLP bestowed on that. And I got to tell you, John, as I told you before, I'm not going to lie to you, man. Being with LP for 27 years and being part of that Garfield family, when we were hosted at DW, when we did the interview, myself and then JR did with you, it was kind of melancholy. Yeah. Yeah, it was kind of melancholy for me to walk through the warehouse in Oxnard and see LP's logo everywhere. But I got to tell you, I've grown and so have the mass of percussionists that are with DW/Toca. And we're thankful because, John, for the longest time, man, we were in that quandary after, and forgive me for being blatant, after Fender fucked everything up. Excuse my French. You know, I'm not gonna lie that they punched a hole
on this show.
Yeah, and fuck all day long. And I'll say it again. Fender fucked up LP. And if it wasn't for Mr. Don Lombardi and John Good that came in and punched, repaired the holes that Fender punched in this, we're putting LP back on top like it's always has been. And we thank you for that. And, you know, and thank you for, you know, for taking the time out with Jamie. And, you know, I knew that we were going to catch you right when you got off a plane, but it was definitely well worth it. So I'm going to step back and let you guys finish up your conversation and tell each other how much you guys love each other.
Yeah, yeah, cool, man. And thank you. And don't forget, Criss Lombardi is like a major man who drives all this stuff these days. I mean, he's taken over. He's driving. But getting back to where we are, and I know this is not my interview, for Christ's sake. It's,
John, I love listening to you talk. So you take as much. Like I said, this is a treat for me. So
No. It's a treat for me to always be with you. Yeah. And the other day when we hung out, and who was that cat you had with you?
He's my drum tech, Gooch Ibarra.
Gooch, yeah. Man, is he great or what?
He's incredible. He's incredible.
You know, and we wound up putting together a drum kit that was so great, and
I have to hype on that for 2 seconds and tell you, Jackie, and anyone that's listening too, that every time I have Kenny even say I referred to John and DW about being a kid in a candy store or Christmas morning, again, about 3 weeks ago in talking about this upcoming tour and, you know, talking to John, we designed a kit that, again, you got to take the Timeless Timber kit out of the, and that just is on a shelf by itself, bar none. But my point is, you talk about, I feel like, how I feel right now is I will get this kit in the next couple of weeks right before we start rehearsals. And you talk about the feeling of Christmas. This is the hardest 3 weeks I've ever had to wait in my entire life. I wake up every morning. You talk about expressing gratitude to my maker for where I'm at, is that I have this to look forward to. This kit is going to be mind blowing. I can't even tell you how excited I am to sit behind these drums and play this music on this tour with these guys. I can't even tell you. It's by far going to be it's the highlight of my career, bar none to this point. So I'm so incredibly turned on.
And let me tell you, Jamie, also 2 days ago or 3 days ago, I got a knock at the front door in my home studio, and UPS brings in this big box and it's emblazoned with the name DW, Drum Workshop. Yeah. And they bestowed on me a brand new cajon that is so apropos for my home studio. So John and the gang, thank you for that so much, guys. I mean, I can't tell you. And, you know, and John, again, that's too, cool. Thank you, my dear friend. And everybody, I'm going to get a little spoiler alert. John and I have been kind of chopping it up, but now that John's back in town and with Mr. Lombardi, I am going to go out of my wheelhouse other than talking to the players, but I'm actually going to be talking to the principals of DW, which I'm going to be hosting. They hosted us. I'm going to host Don and John on a segment on Jackie's Groove, because God knows, I mean, how many people that you guys have touched. And also, too, thanks to John, I've got coming up on the show soon, Mr. Rob Wallace and Steve Smith from Journey. And thanks to Mr. Good for that, putting that together. So with that said, you know, I'm going to get back to everything. John, I love you. Welcome back. I want a personal invite for the ice cream social I know coming up soon.
Because
you know we'll be there, brother.
Man, that's coming up July 1.
I know. That's why I brought it up. I'm like a Jewish grandmother. I'm throwing guilt without using my arms right now, so I hope it worked.
And Jamie, you're probably going to be on the road, right?
I will be. Actually, July 1st, I will be here. I have a 6-day break. I don't fly out. If it's July 1st, I know that I get home end of June, and I don't leave again until July 2nd. So if it's on the 1st, I can be there.
We got the taco truck backing up my driveway, which is like a big, long, tall driveway. And yep. these guys make the best tacos in the world, Tacos de Pueblo.
Yep.
And we'll have about 100 people here who are the coolest frickin' people you've ever met in your life. And it's a lot of your friends, Jamie.
Yeah.
It's a lot of your friends, Jackie.
Yeah.
And you know what? It's like the Church of Monday Night Football, is which yep. I've been doing since 1988, and I'm the pastor of the church.
I love it.
So, I mean,
hallelujah.
You know, if this whole drum thing works out, great. But if it doesn't, I've got the Church of Monday Night Football.
I love it. Sanctified. I will be there. Jackie and I will both be there with bells on.
Absolutely.
I certainly hope so, man. I love
John,
being
Mr.
here
John.
With you guys.
Yeah.
And thank you so much. And now I'm going to join my wife on the couch.
Amen.
John, and thank you so much. And everybody, please do us a favor and patronize dwdrums.com, the world's leader when it comes to trap set drums, and also lpmusic.com, the world leader for percussion. John, I love you, brother. Thank you so much. Welcome home.
I love you, John. Bless. Thank you.
Jamie, I love you, man. I can't wait to see you. A big kiss, okay?
Big kiss to you. Welcome home. I love you, man. Thank you for everything.
Thank you. It's nice to be back in America.
All right.
All right, Johnny. God bless.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
All right. Okay, perfect. There you go. Surprise, my brother. This is your life, Mr. Jamie Wollam.
Oh,
hey,
man,
Jamie,
beyond,
can you
beyond
believe it, man?
Ah.
We are 2 minutes and 50 seconds left of segment number 5. And
okay.
There's so much shit we've got to talk about. There's so many questions. I'm going to ask this question right now. It's a question my wife came up with, and I think it's damn prolific. Think about this for a second.
Mm-hmm.
If Jamie wasn't playing music / drum / guitar,
mm-hmm.
what would Mr. Wollam be doing at this point of his life?
I can answer that. And how long do I have right now, Jackie? A minute and a half?
2 minutes.
Okay. I think I can definitely sum that up. It's really, that's a fascinating question that I've asked myself numerous times over the last 10 years.
Okay.
And to be really blunt with you, I think if I wasn't going to be a musician of any capacity, I would be in the construction business.
Really?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And I doesn't mean that I know a fantastic amount about it now, but I have throughout my younger years and formative years as a teenager and work jobs. I am fascinated and have the deepest respect for people that work with their hands. My uncle, who was also my very first drum teacher, and we can talk about that later. He's the guy who got my dad's youngest brother got me into drumming. He built his house from scratch, literally from the ground up, all of the framing, the cement, the electrical, the plumbing, the ability for a man to do that, to build, or the knowledge and the wherewithal to build something from nothing is my passion.
You know, so. And God bless my Uncle Frank, because my Uncle Frank Bertone, we lost about 10 years ago. Same thing, built the house from the, foundation all the way up itself. So, I'm the kind of guy that I love to see how things are broken down. That's why I loved going to Don Drum Workshop and John taking us through and showing us how the drum starts at its raw stage to the part where they tune it sonically and they ship it out. So with that said, you guys, can you believe this? We're going on 40 seconds left of segment number 5, going into the last segment, second hour. Of this great, great, great interview. And we're going to pick it up and we're going to find out everything that encompasses Mr. Jamie Wollam. We're going to tell you how to stalk him. We're going to tell you his blood type and et cetera, et cetera. So with that said, you guys don't go anywhere. I'm having a great time and I love it. I love it. I love it when I can surprise an artist with respect of people that respect him also. And that was Mr. John Good from Drum Workshop. So guys, don't go anywhere. Last segment, segment number 6 coming up. On Jackie's Groove, this is Jackie Bertone, brought to you by InterTalk Radio Network. You're into all things music. Guys, don't go anywhere. We'll be right back with a short break with my in-studio guest, Mr. Jamie Wollam. Jamie, don't go anywhere. Kids, don't go anywhere. We'll be right back after a short message.
Hi.
Hi, this is Tim Dolbear, host of Sound Experience here on Intertalk Radio. And Source Connect by Source Element is the essential tool that we use to link between my studio in Austin, Texas, and the WS radio station in San Diego. Now, with Source Connect, not only can we communicate in real time and with HD audio, but it's synced up and is of a high enough quality that I can use it for real-time ADR work, remote recording and overdubbing, and it even allows me to remotely control a DAW. Source Connect by Source Element. Affordable, high-quality audio and video connection over the internet for all of your production needs.
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on InterTalk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
Make this your vinyl night. I'm John J.R. Robinson, and every week, music creation comes alive through stories, experiences, and sounds when vinyl records filled our hearts and minds. My friends and I share our tips and techniques used in creation of iconic tracks for recording artists such as Michael Jackson, Eric Clapton, Quincy Jones, and Steve Winwood, to name a few. Vinyl has emerged hot, and the soul of vinyl defines art and passion, which burns deepest at night. Tune in every Wednesday.
Are you serious about your music?
Pacific.
Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.
Welcome to Jackie's Groove. Come journey with us through the rhythm of the music business with your host, Jackie Bertone.
Hey everybody, Jackie Bertone. Welcome back to Jackie's Groove, brought to you by InterTalk Radio. A couple things I just want to throw out here itself. I thanked my sponsors earlier, last segment, but I got to continue to say thank you also to our other large sponsors. First and foremost, our dear friends of ours at Pitbull Audio, Calvin Lee and the Motley Crew, for everything they do for us and how they take care of us and keep this crazy ship afloat. So with that said, please visit them at pitbullaudio.com. And they just want you to play it loud. And also someone I'm sure Jamie is very familiar with, and I know I am, but a company called Studio Instrument Rentals, stir-usa.com, for all of your backline needs. And my newest sponsor, which is Blue Microphone, so that you can reach them at bluemic.com. Thank you. And also my drumstick of choice, Vader Percussion, who I've been going on them 22 years, and same with Sabian Cymbals at 22 years. And with that said, you know, we're very thankful here at InterTalk Radio. You know, we fully vetted my show going in to make sure that nobody else was doing what we're doing. And the thing is that what makes our show, my show, so successful is the fact that we are musicians talking to musicians, basically taking you behind the velvet rope, keeping it real, and sharing anecdotes that you just may not be able to read in Modern Drummer magazine or Guitar Player and so on. And we're very, very proud of that. You know, we were very honored to be the last interview for our blessed brother, Mr. Al Jarreau, who left this earth on February the 12th of this year. And we hope that we don't lose any more, man, because that band in heaven has got to be a It's got to be a mother trucker, as they say. So, but that said, you know, and we're introducing a new artist series. And when I say artist series, not to mention or forget the brothers like myself, like Jamie, the guys that are below the marquee that are actually unsung heroes of what makes the guys above the marquees famous. And we're really proud of doing that. And hopefully maybe down the term later on, we've got some great, great interviews coming up with the who's who of the industry, not just the sidemen like Jamie and myself. And hopefully the interview and the invitation will go out to Roland and also of the principals of obviously Tears for Fears, who is, you know, I'm a fan for. So if I can work on that, that would be great with Roland. And Kurt, you're more than welcome to chop it up on Jackie's Groove. So with that said, you know what? Jamie, you know, I'm thankful for everything. You just spoke to my wife on a break. I'm thankful for this woman. But a person I'm thankful for, not only is he my brother, not only is he a great bass player, he's okay, but he is the CEO of this crazy organization called Intertalk Radio. And we have a little spiel that we do on the last segment. And what I want to do is I want to step back for a second, have a drink of Diet Coke, and I want to bring on Mr. Florentino Buenaventura, CEO of Intertalk Radio. Florentino, say hi to Mr. Jamie Wollam. Jamie, say hi to Florentino.
Hey, Jamie, what's going on, brother?
How are you, Florentino?
I'm doing good, man. I'm an octopus today with multiple hands jumping on to different parts of it. We, like Jackie said, we usually have a few more folks, but my right hand, my, you know, the right
man,
brain,
left you're brain, making it happen. You're making it happen, bro. Thank you.
Hey, it's good. Actually, Jackie surprised me with John. I was just like, oh, John's coming on? Okay, let's do this.
what a treat.
Yeah, man. Hey, first off, I want to say that one of the biggest drivers for, well, not one of the biggest drivers, reason why we have this network is because what Jackie said. We recognize there we got to have a lot of brothers that don't get the, you know, aren't getting the, you know, the due that they might, you know, might be due. And then some of these younger cats that are coming up, you know, with the proliferation of all the stuff on the internet, they're not becoming aware of these amazing players that are supporting the recording artists. So, you know, that's one of the that's the reason why we did that. And much like yourself, it comes from a higher calling for me. You know, I have a big belief in the man upstairs, and that to me is why I do what I do. Cause I also wanted to have a network out there that was supportive, that was, you know, not detractive, that was, you know, about doing something, making a difference. And I can appreciate, exactly. Amen. And I can appreciate what, you know, how you've been inspired to kind of, you know, your life and the story was really touching. And so I wanted to say that. And
thank
say that,
you, Florentino.
You got kindred spirits here. In fact, we've got a show. I'm going to give a plug to our show, Intersect, with Aaron A. Train Smith, who's been a guest on Jackie's show, and he started doing a show with us. He's out in Nashville. It's called Intersect, and it's all about life and music and faith and how it all converges and how it plays a part and, you know, the dynamics that kind of come along with that. And it interviews people that their lives are affected in that way. So,
and not to mention the fact that Aaron is the drummer from the small group called The Temptations also. So let's talk about that.
He played for a little known track called Papa Was a Rolling Stone.
Papa Was a Rolling Stone.
Yeah, exactly. That iconic drumming part was Aaron. So
that's amazing.
Yeah. So, you know, you find one thing I do like about the music business nowadays is that I'm finding that the spirits, because of the challenges that we all face, and that we all kind of have to band together. It's kind of like that movie Independence Day. Everybody was, all the countries before were fighting. Now that, you know, we all have a common goal to make sure that, you know, we have a relevant business. We're all playing together well. So, part of that is what Jackie said is our shtick here is we want to know about you, Jamie. We want our listeners to know about you. Obviously, 2 hours is not enough to define who Jamie is. So there's some other things out there. There's websites. There's Facebook. There's YouTube. Like, I've been playing these great YouTubes today, and you know, I had to get a little bit of the talking points in there because the stories and the history behind why those songs were.
Absolutely.
You know, were became what they became. That's all part of that. So tell us how people can find out about you.
Thank you for that, Florentino. And just appreciate very much what you do there, what you and Jackie have created and what this is all about. It's a real, real blessing to be a part of it. And I respect you guys and support it 100%. As far as any contact with me or being in touch with me, I love being able to connect with people. And I love it. I am a big fan of the human race, and I can tell that. And people that know me know that. Sometimes to a fault or to an overextending of myself, which I'm learning how in time as I get older, how to better navigate time and things like that. But bottom line, I have a website that people can visit. It's just as simple as it sounds. It's jamiewollam.com, JAMIEWOLLAM, as in Michael, jamiewollam.com. I'm on Facebook just with my name, Jamie Wollam, and I'm on Instagram, Jamie Wollam, which I think those are the most the easiest ways to be in contact. Find out. My website has a list of all the upcoming shows that I'm getting ready to do with Tears. I'm actually navigating putting some clinics together while I'm out on this next 3 month, which will be a brand new thing for me. Getting some clinics while I'm out on the road in some of these great cities. And I'm just, so yeah, all the information is on there. You can email me through the website or contact me on Facebook with the messaging thing. I'm honored to anything I can do to give back to either the music community or to another human being. I do my best. I really, really am grateful to be a part of this great thing we call living. You know, I'm just really grateful.
Hey man. Well, hey, one of the things we can actually do right now is I could extend an invitation for you to do a clinic over at Pitbull Audio. That's one of our mm-hmm. you know, big sponsors, and
absolutely,
we do a lot of these. And DW is their only drum line, so kind of
yeah.
it's kind of fitting. So
goes
we could
hand
talk
in hand.
We could talk to John and those guys, and we're down here in San Diego, so you know, we're just a hop, skip, and a jump. So you know,
I would be honored, and we'll absolutely talk to you about it post show. I would absolutely be honored.
Let's do that. We'll put that together right after the show. So you folks that are listening, and you got to tune in and you got to make it down. Even if you're on the other side of the country, you got to come down to Pitbull Audio at pitbullaudio.com and check out Jamie do his thing. So I had to do my radio thing right there.
Jackie,
dig it.
Take it away, Jackie.
All right, guys. Thank you so much for until I'll talk to you later on, brother. Lunch is on the way. Hey,
yeah.
Jamie, let's get back. I've got 1,000 questions, but 8 minutes to do them. So I'm going to I'm going to get a couple things here for a second.
Mm-hmm.
Think about this for a second. This is my idea, and I love the idea because I've experienced it, and most all my my guests have. I want you to stop and think real quick. Think really hard. Where mm-hmm. were you? What were you doing? When did you hear yourself on the radio for the very first time? What was that song?
That's a fascinating question. You know what? It was actually hearing myself on the radio proper, like being in a car driving and hearing myself on the radio was when it was 19. I want to say. It was 2000, oddly enough, about 2004. And I was playing with a band. I was with a band called Avion, which was a post group that was myself and a singer by the name of Steve Bertrand. We were in a band together called the Tories years ago. That was sort of a Brit pop, very pop, kind of sounded like a mixture of Jellyfish and Squeeze. If you know those bands, very English,
Absolutely.
Kind of big harmonies, but really catchy melodic tunes. And we left that band and started a band called Avion, which was a little bit more mainstream, kind of in the vein of Matchbox 20, Coldplay kind of vibe. And we got signed to Columbia Records and had a single that called 7 Days Without You that was doing very well on the charts. And we were on a radio promo tour for that single. And I remember just when we had heard that the song was starting to really break, we walked out to the car from an interview we had done at a radio station and turned on the radio, and lo and behold, it was on the radio and as in the car as we were driving. And that's the first time I can honestly say that was me hearing myself play drums and sing on a tune coming through the radio. And it was magical. It was really magical. It was 2004. So about,
and don't lie, my brother, don't lie, but tell me you didn't shed a tear.
Oh, absolutely. I absolutely did. I couldn't believe it. It was one of the most monumental points for me as a musician, because you strive for that your whole life. You want to be able to do something that people can appreciate and that they are touched by, and to actually have the chance to hear it and see how the machine works. And yeah, it was amazing.
That's so cool that you said that, because I remember mine was in, I think it was 1991, way back when, with my dear friend of mine from Hawaii, Henry Capono, and some guy by the name of Michael McDonald, and a song called Same World. And I was at Fashion Island, Newport Beach, with my windows up. I was crying. I wanted to yell to the highest mountains for everybody. That's fucking me, you know?
Yeah,
and,
of course.
And to this day, I can be in stores and I can hear the hits I've been blessed to play on. And I, you know, being a 56-year-old guy, I don't say much. I just kind of stop and I smile, you know? And let me ask another question. This is the question I talked to you about a couple segments ago that I ask my players and my players, my interviewers, my players. Yeah. A lot of them don't like the question. They don't like it just for the fact is they don't want to be pigeonholed. But I'm going to ask you anyways, brother.
Yeah.
I'm going to ask you one instrument, one answer.
Yeah.
And for player-wise, if you had to choose your favorite keyboard player, who is it? One answer.
Favorite keyboard player? Oh, that's a tough one. One answer. Favorite keyboard player. I'm going to probably say it's going to be a weird one, but I'll tell you, it's a tie, and they're so polar opposite, but I got to say a tie, and that would either be, in my heart, it would be Chick Corea, or it would be Jonathan Cain. As bizarrely different as that is.
Yeah, you went on both sides right there.
Yeah.
And because congratulations to Jonathan.
Yeah, I can appreciate Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, man. I just watched that induction yesterday morning, and I got to tell you, man.
Me too.
Such a difference in styles, of course, but you talking proficient and beyond technically talented Chick Corea, it gets no more skilled than that. And as far as the ability to take a chord progression and make a song that will stand the test of time 50 years from now is something like, Don't Stop Believing. I mean, you hear that piano part and it's iconic. So that to me, there's just as much talent in both of those.
Not to mention the fact of all the talent he brought from his old group, The Babies. I mean, that's exactly. We can't forget about that either.
Of course.
Bassist.
You're going to think I'm full of shit, but I'm going to tell you, Kurt Smith is one of my favorite. I've played with a lot of bass players. Kurt Smith is a incredible bass player. One of the easiest bass players I ever played with. I'm going to say John Entwistle. As weird as it sounds, John. I think he's probably one of my all time favorites.
It's all about the lock and the groove. Let's talk about guitarist.
Yeah. That one, God, I mean, to nail one answer, I'm just going to say probably, God darn it, man. You got me. I'm going to say one of my favorite guitar players to listen to of all time would have to be Joe Walsh.
Dig it. That's my boy. Yeah. And here's a tough one. Percussionist. Jackie Bertone.
I was just going to say, come on, man. I mean, that's a no-brainer. Yeah.
I walked into that one.
You and my dear friend Rich Mangiacaro are two of the most amazing percussionists, rhythmicists that I've ever had the pleasure of either talking to,
listening
to. Rich
is a bad boy, man.
Yeah, man. Your resume goes long and deep. And like I said, this is like a dream. I keep pinching myself going, I'm actually in the same arena talking to you and among the peers of guys, like I said, with John Collins, just everybody. I have to pinch myself to remind myself that this is real and how grateful I am for my life today. It's mind blowing.
Last musician, drummer.
Yeah. I'm going to go back and say, and right now I would say as far as influence on me by far and still to the day I die will be John Bonham. But I got to tell you, in the last 2 months, I'm going to tell you, I have a refound inspiration for just technical ability. And I would have to say Buddy Rich. I just watched a snare drum solo that's on YouTube of him standing there with a small brass quartet doing a snare drum solo that literally brought me to tears. I can't even I've never seen anyone play with that much technique, nor do I think I am hard pressed to think there will ever be anybody else that will play with that kind of technique that Buddy Rich did.
Following up here and the last thing here in the 50 seconds, also I'm going to say it to yourself. Congratulations on your endorsements with DW, with Paiste Cymbals, and also with Vic for Drumsticks, my brother. It's good to be.
And I need to tell you this, Jackie, because this is even news to you probably, and you said it earlier. What? But I just in the last two weeks, I switched, and I am now a proud member of the Vader percussion family.
Oh, welcome to the family, brother. Welcome. Yes.
So I'm honored to say that.
I knew that, and I'm sorry I forgot about that.
No, it's all good. No problem. Chad, I just wanted to say it. Yeah, Chad.
Sorry about that, Chad, and sorry about that, Ron, and sorry about that, Alan, but we'll make up for it.
Hey. Chad is a fantastic human being, and I'm honored to take their sticks out on this next tour. I'm really
stoked.
There
you go, brother. We owe each other a pair of our sticks when we see each other's guys. But that said, say goodbye to my dear friend, my new friend, Mr. Jamie Wollam from Tears for Fears. You guys, check out Tears for Fears' website. for a show coming to your town soon. They're supporting Mr. Hall and Oates. And what an amazing interview today. Thank you so much, Jamie. I'll send you the link. Everybody else, continue to listen to Jackie's Groove, Jackie Bertone, InterTalk Radio. We love you guys. I always finish my shows by saying, Jamie, peace through music, my brother. God bless.
Love you, Jackie. Thank you.
This is Jackie Bertone from Jackie's Groove. Come join me weekly on my journey through the music business as I take you behind the velvet rope, interviewing industry notables such as Al DiMeola, Michael McDonald, and Al Jarreau, to name but a few. Listen to their stories on being in the studios recording number one hits and onto the stages throughout the globe. Allow me to be your music historian. You can hear me live every Monday at 2 p.m. and every Wednesday at 12 noon Pacific Standard Time or 24/7 on jackiesgroove.com. Ready to get your groove on?
Hi, this is Tim Dolbear from Eclectica Studios. I'm a full-time mixing and recording engineer. I work with Grammy winners, labels, and indie artists. Using state-of-the-art digital mixing and restoration tools and the very best in analog gear. Really, though, it's my ability to bring tracks to life and fulfill your vision for your music. This has made me sought after by producers and artists worldwide. So spend your time working on music and not chasing a mix down a rabbit hole. Go to timdolbear.com and check out our free one song mix offer.
You know what's all around you every waking moment of your life? Marketing. You're choking on it. I'm Scott Robertson, and when it comes to strategic PR, branding, and marketing, I've seen it all. And actually, I'm still seeing it because bad marketing never sleeps. Join me each week on May the Best Brand Win, right here on InterTalk Radio, and learn how to make the marketing for your brand unforgettable.
Are you serious about your music? Are you ready to run with the big dogs? The experts at Pitbull Audio have the gear to get you into the game. From leading manufacturers like Mesa Boogie, Fender, Pioneer, and American Audio, to sound your best, you need the best. Pitbull Audio can deliver in rehearsal, on stage, and into the big time. Dropping beats, shredding guitar, or making the crowd roar. Whatever you dream, Pitbull Audio can help make it happen. We are Pitbull Audio. We want you to play it loud. PitbullAudio.com.